वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल द स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ क्लास 12th एंड स्टूडेंट्स एज यू नो वी वर डूइंग द फोर्थ चैप्टर ऑफ योर न्यू रिवाइज सिलेबस एंड द चैप्टर्स नेम इज साउथ एशिया एंड द कंटेम्प्रेरी वर्ल्ड बट इन योर एनसीईआरटी यू विल फाइंड द नेम ऑफ द चैप्टर एज कंटेम्प्रेरी साउथ एशिया एंड दिस इज अ पार्ट थर्ड एंड द टॉपिक विच वी आर कवरिंग इज मोनार्की एंड द डेमोक्रेसी इन नेपाल एज आई टोल्ड यू वी हैड स्टार्टेड विद द कंट्रीज ऑफ साउथ एशिया एंड वन ऑफ द इंपॉर्टेंट कंट्रीज ऑफ साउथ एशिया एंड वी आर डिस्कसिंग द एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ डेमोक्रेसीज इन दीज बिग कंट्रीज ऑफ साउथ एशिया ओके ऑल्दो आई सेड वी विल नॉट टॉक अबाउट इंडिया हेयर एज रिगार्डिंग इंडिया वी विल बी कंप्लीटली डिस्कसिंग इन डिटेल द पॉलिटिक्स ऑफ इंडिया डेमोक्रेसी इन द अदर बुक दैट इज द पार्ट बी ऑफ पॉलिटिकल साइंस दैट इज पॉलिटिक्स इन इंडिया सिंस इंडिपेंडेंस एंड फॉर दिस लेक्चर वी विल टॉक अबाउट नेपाल एंड द टॉपिक इज मोनार्की एंड डेमोक्रेसी इन नेपाल सो वी विल सी द स्टोरी एंड द एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ नेपाल वेयर दे एस्टैब्लिश्ड डेमोक्रेसी आफ्टर मोनार्की वेयर देयर यूज टू बी अ किंग रूल सो नेपाल इज आर नेबरिंग कंट्री इट्स अ स्मॉल कंट्री very close to our boundary or sharing our international boundary. So Nepal was a Hindu kingdom in the past. So if we talk about the past of Nepal, it used to be a Hindu kingdom and then a constitutional monarchy. And after if we see it in the modern period, we'll see it was called the constitutional monarchy. Constitutional monarchy means monarchy existed there. That is, a king's rule was there, but his powers were limited by the constitution. It means there was a parliament, there was a representation to the government by the people of the country, but still at the peak, we would say the head was the monarch, that is a king, in the modern period of for many years. So we'll see the story that how from a Hindu kingdom it became a monarchy and monarchy to a constitutional monarchy and finally achieved and established democracy and constitution of their country. So we'll talk about that story. So the first point is king had a full control over the people of Nepal through army. So the people of army were totally controlled by the king and the power of the king was because of its army or the troops. So through his troops, he used to exercise and control the power, its power or show its dominance over the people of Nepal with the help of the army. Throughout this period, the political parties and common people wanted to establish democracy. If you see the history of Nepal, from a very long time, people of this Nepal region, they always wanted to have a democracy in place, as they have seen the example of India, Sri Lanka, their neighboring countries. So they also wanted that the people of Nepal should have democracy, freedom, justice, equality, right to opportunity. So they wanted to have a democratic country where they will have a true representation in their government and their decision making. But the king retained full control, and it is obvious everyone wants to have power. So king, the powers were centralized and in single-handedly vested in the hands of the king. So king always opposed and retained full control with the help of the army. So army played a very important role where king always retained the full control over the people of Nepal. All the people, although the people were not satisfied, they wanted to have democracy in place where and a true representative democracy, same like in India and Sri Lanka. And so the king restricted expansion of democracy. So whenever people tried to expand the pro-democracy movements and they started some protest, king used to just settle down these people and he did not allow any people to expand the ideas of democracy in Nepal. So in 1990, due to the strong, now the people started protesting all around the country and there was pro-democratic movements. Means there were movements and demonstrations and turmoils, I would say, disturbance all around the country for bringing democracy to their country. So it was very strong now, where people of the various sections of the society came together, rich, poor, irrespective of the gender, all of them came together to join this movement that was called pro-democratic movement in 1990s. And the king accepted. So the king was forced as his subjects were revolting and he had to accept the demand for the new democratic constitution. So he gave some freedom and he listened to the demand of the people, where people wanted a democratic constitution in the world if I'm saying democratic constitution, it means they formed their parliament, and in that parliament people had the right to elect their government and the head of the government. But the democracy was short-lived and troublesome. But in that case, we are talking about here constitutional monarchy. It means the king had allowed to have a democratic constitution, that they can have a government, but still the major power was controlled by the king. And that is why this democracy was short-lived. This democracy was established for a very short time, and it was troublesome. Okay, it means it was not stable. There was instability if you talk about a democratic government after 1990s. Okay, and the reason for this is why it was unstable and democracy could not prevail for a long period of time. Because of the triangular conflict, there was a conflict going on, violence and tension going on between the three groups in Nepal, prevalent groups: monarchist, the noble class, the elite class, and the king. Those are called the monarchist. Democrats were the people who were joining the movements for a strong pro-democratic movement, okay, who supported and wanted to bring democracy in Nepal. Those were Democrats. And Moiths were the people who were totally against this elite and monarch or the king. So there was always violence activities going between these Moiths and the monarchist army. So when there was a triangular conflict going on between these, there was a situation of unrest in Nepal. So finally, king abolished the parliament in 2002. Whatever autonomy the king had given to form and establish the new constitution in 1990s after the strong pro-democratic movements, that was again abolished in 2002 by the king because of this triangular conflict and tensions in Nepal, which even ended the limited democracy. So with this action of the king, where he abolished the parliament or the constitution, the democratic constitutional government, like that the king ended the limited democracy Nepal had. Limited word has been used because that was not the complete or true democracy which was established in Nepal, because still the powers were with the king. But the king had permitted and given the permission to have a democracy or government in place. But this was abolished in 2002. A massive countryside after that, there was a massive protest against the king's rule here. A massive countrywide means whole country was involved now. All the sections of the society came together because they were not happy with the action of the king, that once he had established the democratic constitution, then again in 2002 he abolished it. So now again there was a countrywide pro-democracy protest which took place in 2006. And achieved first major victory to force king. Now, and they achieved the first major victory, I would say. Previously, it was a limited autonomy given to the people, but now this was a true autonomy where people got the victory, and king was forced to restore. The king was forced by his subjects, because there was so much of demonstration going around in the country, that he was forced to restore the House of Representatives. House of Representatives means parliament, the parliament of Nepal. So he re-established the House of Representation or the parliament, and they are still working on democracy. But Nepal's transition to democracy is not complete. Okay, it is still moving towards the framing of the Constituent Assembly. Nepal's transition to democracy, if we talk about the transition from a monarchy to a democracy, is almost complete for Nepal. Nepal has undergone a unique movement in its history because it formed a Constituent Assembly too. Draft a constitution for Nepal. Some section of the Nepal and the people of Nepal thought that having a complete democratic government is not good for Nepal, as there should be a nominal monarchy in place so that we can connect with our past, as the past of the Nepal was totally based on monarchy or the king's rule. But the Moist group, the people who were against the monarchs, who were against the kings, the group agreed to suspend armed struggle. Now they had stopped their armed struggle because now there was a democracy in place. They wanted the constitution to include. The demand of these Moist people was that whatever the constitution will be framed for Nepal, it should include the programs of social and economic restructuring. It means social and economic plans and procedures or whatever policies will be implemented should be restructured and re-implemented. All the parties in SPA, okay, seven party alliance did not agree with this program, the MOIST and some of the political. Now some section of the society, these are the MOIST, and some political groups were also deeply suspicious. Now they were suspicious and they doubted of the Indian government, as India is a very close country to Nepal. So they doubt, these MOIST and some political group, they doubt that India and its role in future of Nepal. What will be the role of Indian government in the future of Nepal, as Nepal has opted as a democratic country, they have established democracy. So what will be the role of Indian government, because they suspected that Nepal can be overtook by India. So this was just a suspicion from them. But in 2008, Nepal became a democratic republic. So you have to remember. So finally in 2008, Nepal became a democratic republic. Republic word, as you must be knowing from the very junior classes, republic is a form of government where the government is elected by the people and the head of the government is also elected by the people. Okay, after abolishing the monarchy. So the monarchy was now completely abolished, and finally in 2015 it adopted a new constitution. So new constitution was framed, which was adopted in 2015. So these are the two important dates which you need to remember. So now the next topic is ethnic conflict and democracy in Sri Lanka. Since we are discussing about the experiences of democracy in various bigger countries of South Asia, but here we will, as we know, Sri Lanka has established democracy just after their independence in 1948. They have continued with the democratic form of the government. But here the problem and is different for Sri Lanka, as in this region they have a different sort of a problem, that is ethnic conflict. If the meaning of ethnic is, I would say ethnic is relating to a different racial or cultural group, people of a various racial group or a cultural group, and that is why it's written ethnic conflict. So there were two ethnic or the cultural groups who were into conflict. And we'll also talk about, along with that, we'll also talk about democracy in Sri Lanka. So basically this is going to be the matter of concern here, where we will be discussing what are the two cultural groups or the racial groups which are into conflict and which has created a lot of problems for the Sri Lankan government to maintain a democratic character of their country. So Sri Lanka, first of all, as you know, older name of Sri Lanka is Ceylon, okay, has been able to retain democracy since in independence from 1948. So it has also successfully tried and retained, although there was various challenges, problems and various circumstances where they could have easily moved to the other form of government, but somehow they retained the democracy after their independence. They got the independence in 1948, India got in 1947. So India has also maintained the democracy, and Sri Lanka also. So but the problem here is different, other than, like, we talked about Pakistan and we talked about Nepal. So we saw various pro-democratic movements going around in the country by the people of the country to throw out the military rule or the monarch, okay, and finally they established democracy in their country, and they formed their own constitutions also. But here the problem is different. So the problem of Sri Lanka is it is having two ethnic groups or the two cultural groups. One is Sinhala and the other is Tamils, okay, and under Sinhala you can see it is a majority of the people are Sinhalas here, and Tamils are in minority. So if we talk which section of the community is into majority, so majority are Sinhalas and Tamils are into minorities. Sinhalas are the original settlers of the Sri Lankan land, although it is said that Tamils are the people who have migrated from India into Sri Lanka after independence also. So these are the people who have moved to Sri Lanka from India, and these are the original people of the Sri Lanka, and they think that this land of Sri Lanka belongs to Sinhalas. So all the powers and representation should be with the Sinhalas only. So this is the conflict between the Sinhalas and the Tamils, where Tamils feel neglected by the Sri Lankan governments. They are not being given any representation in the government, okay, they are being discriminated on the basis of their caste, color, language, religion and many more. So here, moving forward to explain you the same things, Sri Lanka community is called Sinhalas and Indian community is called Tamils, as I have explained you already. The main, so see the problem here, the main problem in Sri Lanka is community and controversy is regarding Tamils that belong to India. So the main problem in Sri Lanka is community and controversy is regarding, so all the people of Sri Lanka who are Sinhalas, they have a problem with this section of the society. Those are called the Tamils, who have migrated from India. So, and Sinhala people, the people of the Sri Lanka, enjoy more privileges. Okay, so the people of the Sinhalas have the more privileges. They have the more representation in the government, rights in the Sri Lanka. While Tamils, if we compare it with the people of Tamil who have settled in Sri Lanka, they have been always neglected by the Sri Lankan government. At every field, every sphere of life, they are being neglected, they are being discriminated. They are not being accepted as a part of Sri Lanka. So this is the major conflict between these two sections of the society or the community, Sinhalas and Tamils. So this has been an ongoing process since the independence of India and Sri Lanka after 1947 and 1948. So in 1983, what happened, when something happens, whenever there is a problem and conflict and disturbance in Sri Lanka, anything is wrong with the Tamils there in Sri Lanka. So the people of the Indian Tamils, or we can say the Indian Tamils, they create pressure on the government, on the Indian government. So if any event is taking place in Sri Lanka and any activities are going in Sri Lanka which are against the people of Sri Lanka, Tamils in Sri Lanka, or some activities are performed where these Tamils are being suppressed by the Sri Lankan government, in that case the Indian Tamils create pressure on our Indian government to negotiate with Sri Lankan government on the Tamil question. They tell the Indian government that Indian government should intervene and should try to find solutions and negotiate with the Sri Lankan government on the question of Tamil question, that they should be given the autonomy in Sri Lanka as well. Why they are being so much discriminated, why they are being so ignored, why they are not enjoying any privileges same like the Sinhalas. So Indian Tamils always force the Indian government to initiate. Finally, in 1983, so you have to remember, when these Tamils of Sri Lanka were not supported, they were not given autonomy, they were not given privileges, even they were not recognized properly by the Sri Lankan government. So finally, they had taken a decision in 1983 where they formed their militant group, and the name of the militant group was LTTE, that is Liberation Tigers of Tamil Eelam. It's written here, in 1983, Tamilian people organized a militant group. They formed their militant group. Its name was Liberation Tigers of Tamil Eelam, popularly known as LTTE. And why this group was formed? It's a militant group. It was formed to fight against the Sri Lankan army, as a lot of problems were faced by the Tamils in Sri Lanka. They were being ignored and neglected, and there were a lot of armed insurgencies also where these people suffered a lot. So to come out and take a stand for themselves, now they formed this group to protect them. But although this was wrong, in 1987, so the next important date is 1987, the government of India got directly involved in Sri Lanka, Sri Lankan equation, and sent its peacekeeping forces to Sri Lanka. As I said, whenever there was any problem or any incident took place against the Tamils in Sri Lanka, Indian government was forced by the Indian Tamils to negotiate with the Sri Lankan government. So finally, Indian government signed an accord with Sri Lankan government, where in 1977, India sent its peacekeeping forces. So you can understand by the force, the army was sent, but this army was not sent to fight against any of the armies of Sri Lanka or the Tamils, but it was for peacekeeping, to maintain peace and to find a solution to stabilize the situations in Sri Lanka between the Sinhalas and the Tamils. So Indian finally moved into Sri Lanka here. But here, things did not go according to these peacekeeping forces of India. When India sent this force, this force was attacked by the LTTE. India had come to stabilize the situation between Sri Lanka and LTTE, but LTTE attacked on the Indian peacekeeping forces, and there was a situation of turmoil and violence in Sri Lanka. And this incident was not liked by the Sri Lankan government. Although they had signed the accord where they allowed Indian forces to come as a peacekeeping forces, but when they saw conflict with LTTE, okay, so then in this case Sri Lankan government did not like this act of Indian government. So the Sri Lankan government opposed Indian interference. So now the Sri Lankan government opposed the interference of India, and they called this is an internal conflict, and India has to take its army back. So they said that now India is interfering in the internal matters or the internal affairs of Sri Lanka, and since now India should take away its army back. So in 1989, they came in 1987, and in 1989, the Indian government called back its peacekeeping forces without achieving the aims and objectives, or the targets, I would say. And the objectives and targets and aim was this peacekeeping forces was to stabilize the situation in Sri Lanka, to stabilize the situations between Sinhalas and Tamils. They wanted to find a solution to the permanent solution to the problems which were going on in Sri Lanka. But things could not go with the way Indian peacekeeping forces wanted. And finally, they had to come back to India in 1989. Despite internal conflicts, Sri Lanka has. So apart than that, despite internal conflicts, there has been internal conflicts and disturbances in Sri Lanka, but still Sri Lanka has focused and maintained its democratic political system, because there were so many challenges that easily Sri Lanka would have opted for the other form of the government. But Sri Lanka government was successful where it maintained its democratic political system in all the problems and all the challenges, and registered along with the democratic political system, they also registered considerable economic growth. They also had the economic growth and high level of human development. So this is a big achievement by Sri Lanka, I would say, as an important country of South Asia. We are having so much of internal conflicts and turmoils between two big ethnic groups for a long period of time, but still they maintained their democratic political system. They had come out with a very good economic growth and high level of human development as well. And also, Sri Lanka is also the country which has successfully controlled, or one of the important and the country which has successfully controlled on the rate of growth of population. They had controlled their population well beforehand, and highest GDP growth for many years. And for many years after independence, that this was a country which was having the highest GDP, that is gross domestic product, for many years. By this GDP, we can understand the level of the particular country. It's a developing country, developed countries, or underdeveloped countries. And when we talked about the problems between the two ethnic groups, so, and there was a lot of conflicts and violence and turmoil going on in Sri Lanka. So Norway and Iceland negotiated between India and Sri Lanka. So there was a problem between Sri Lanka and India also. So they negotiated and tried to resolve the problems between India and Sri Lanka relating to the ethnic conflicts in this region. Okay, so this was all about Sri Lanka today and Nepal, and how they have established, about Nepal it was how they have established democracy after strong pro-democratic movements around the country, and they removed the monarchy and established the democracy and also formed their constitution. But in the case of Sri Lanka, we discussed how these ethnic groups, two ethnic groups, were creating problems for the Sri Lankan government. Apart than that, they managed to somehow establish and maintain their democratic political system. Okay, so this was all for this topic now.